How y'all doing this morning? Tired? Okay, that's an answer. Huh? Good. Awesome. Well, thank God for we are here today. We are here to hear from God. And you know, today's word, I thank God for it. You hear me say that often, but today especially because I love when God gives us something as a prophecy or give us something about current events. And so today you're here, the title that you see it, it says, Returning from Captivity. And as I was praying this morning, God was giving me this word, and he gave me, the title, and well, not only gave me the title, right? He started beginning to give me the passage of Scripture. And as I'm just talking with him and all of that, and I begin to sit down and begin to look at this passage of Scripture. And I'm like, God, what in the world? And as God was giving it to me, as I was beginning to read it, he began to speak to me through his spirit, and I began to understand what he meant and why he wanted this message to come forward on the day. I think it would be a blessing because God often speaks to his children. And we might not even understand what he's saying, why he's saying it, and all of these things, but I can promise you this, I can speak for me, I don't make up anything. And so when God is speaking, and you hear a message, it'll be wise to pay attention to it. And so I thank God on the day that he's given us a current word. You know, I'm often grateful for that because it's just a reminder to me that God hears my prayers. It's a reminder to me that God is right there with us as we go through our day-to-day activities. He's with us as we go through our highs, our celebrations, and he's with us as we go through our lows. He's with us as we go as the world and the society makes a turn for the left or for the right. And he's there with us to guide us through every step. And so I thank him for just being present. I don't know how often you spend time with God and listen to him as he talks back. It's normal for us as Christians, we know to pray. But it's something more powerful when you begin to allow God to speak back to you. And if you're not careful, because I know about this, as religion, growing up in religion, and God breaking me out of religion and teaching me spirit, that oftentimes, even while you're praying to God, and God, if you know he's listening, as he begins to speak, y'all been telling myself, and you know I don't have a problem with that, because what I found out when I tell myself, there's often a lot of other people that have done the same thing. But as long as we keep hush-hush, nobody gets delivered. But while I was talking about, oftentimes you find out when you're praying. And you begin to hear God speak back to you if you're not careful because of the religiosity or religion that you put yourself under. While God's speaking, you begin to talk over him. Anybody ever done that? Y'all don't have the answer. I'll say I have. God's talking, and the whole time here I go again, just praising him over his voice. That's what God is often trying to teach us. Everything that a lot of things that we grew up thinking it was to honor God, oftentimes it was often just matched with religion. And when I say matched with religion, there's times that because we know Sunday, for example, we often go preach, pray, and we worship God. But sometimes we only do it on Sunday. And if you look at it that way, you fail yourself in a religion or a constant religious pattern. Okay, how many of y'all know God will hear from you every day? Did you know that? Every day. Every day. He waiting to hear from you. Every day. Do you know that he talks to you? Do you know that? And he talked. Sometimes you hear his voice. Sometimes you just get a strong desire to do something that was God leading. But oftentimes he's just sitting back. He's like, look, he's talking, and sometimes we're not even paying attention. You ever heard people say, something told me to do blah, 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 blah. You ever heard them say, you know, that was God that told them that? Especially when it comes out good, right? It's like, say this, you said, I'm not going to do this. If I do it, then they may look at me funny, but then by you not doing it, something kind of bad happens. You ever had that happen? Then you know for a fact it was God that was leading you the whole time. So, we're not going to spend a lot of time today out. What we're going to most likely do is hear a couple songs and go straight into the Word, because this Word that God has given us is so powerful for what is about to happen. I don't consider myself a prophet. What I do consider myself is a child of God. And the Word of God teaches us in Revelation that those that have an ear, let them hear what the Spirit of God says to the church, what the Spirit is saying to the churches. So that means that if any child of God, God will speak to you. Did you catch that? So that's why I'm not going to sit here and say, okay, I'm a prophet. I'm a child of God. And any child of God, God will speak to you. And so today is one of those messages that I'm not going to prolong a lot. I want us to get into this Word because, of course, it's the most important thing about me. Is that that's true to you? Is it because your mom and daddy made you come? You sure? All right. Let me have us a song, and then we're going to go on to pray. We do pray before we go live, so it's not the first prayer, but we're going to have a song.
Let's sing together. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. So there is power in the name of Jesus. Come to break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, yeah. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Let's sing together, there is power. There is power.
Now have access to the power of God. God. Concerning you, concerning your situations, even concerning other people. That comes from the power of the ascension of Jesus Christ. So when you hear people say there's power in the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus is a reminder of our acceptance and now entrance into the power of God. It came through Jesus. It came through the acceptance. It came through the life of Jesus Christ. It came through the death of Jesus Christ. It came through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Especially the last two. The death of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus gave us access to the power of God. I want you to remember something. We're made in God's image. That's how God made us. So look, if I say you are made in, if I say you are made in my image, then you expect to be able to do the same things I do, right? Makes sense? As my children, you're expected, when people see you, they're expecting to see certain characteristics. That you're gonna, they remember that your dad and your father had. It makes sense? Same as when they see you, they say, okay, I know your mom, there are certain things, there are certain characteristics that you have because they know and they recognize and they're looking for certain characteristics of your mama because they know your mama. And so they're looking at you and say, yeah, okay, yeah, she do that because, yeah, she got that from her mom. As children of God, we are made in God's image. Okay? God created us in his image. So, there are things that we have like God. You get it? But through Jesus, we were able to pass from the man or woman of sin because of Adam. We were cursed because of Adam, because of him falling. You notice I didn't say Eve. I said Adam. So now through Jesus, we have authority and we have power. That makes sense. Makes sense. You sure? Makes sense. I already know it. You ain't got to give me that out. So check this out. As children of God, you have to remember something. So now, what God's been leading me about, because we might be going to the Word. Y'all okay with going straight to the Word? Y'all want to hear another song or two? Step around. I said, we're going to pray. Yeah, we got to pray. Y'all don't mind me. I ain't got the bulletin. We pass our programs out here. All right, let's pray. Let's go. Y'all ready? Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace and your mercy. We thank you right now for your power. We thank you, Father, for allowing us to be in your presence. God, we thank you for your entrance. The entrance you provide for every child of God through faith and accepting of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for the entrance and allowing us to go in and be able to dwell in your presence and in your power and in your very being. God, we thank you. Right now, God, I'm asking that you will open up our spiritual eyes and allow us to see more of you and allow us to hear more of you. God, take us out of the little small box that we put you in and open us up to your wisdom. God, we need more of you and we thank you because you said, whosoever will, let them come. So God, we're standing there waiting on you to do what you do. We thank you, Father, for giving us what we can handle of your wisdom, of your power, of your anointing, of your grace, of your mercy, and of all the characteristics of you. We thank you for giving us a portion of what we can handle on this side. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Check this out, y'all. I said we're going to pray, we're going straight to the Word. Y'all okay? We're going straight in? Y'all sure? Okay, good deal. This lesson that God gave us today is out of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, the 7th chapter. Now, when coming up with the verses and all of that stuff, God just told me to put Nehemiah in the 7th chapter. It is not the entire chapter, because there's a lot of verses in Nehemiah. But what we're really going to be looking at is starting at verse 4. And I didn't want to put the amount because I knew that some would say, oh, ain't no way this world can stick around for the reading of the entire chapter. But God is not going to allow me to read the entire chapter. But starting at verse 4, you see the title that God gave me was, what, Returning from Captivity, right? Yeah, there you go. Good job. Returning from Captivity. Well, let me give you a little background on where God was leading me to in this message. Returning from captivity. We see a bunch of times where God returned his people from a place of bondage. Bondage is captivity. We see countless times in the Word of God where there was a group of people that were taken through some sort of war or some sort of conflict or some sort of battle. These people were now confiscated, and they stayed in bondage for a period of time. And at some point, oftentimes, we see where they got released and then returned back from their captivity. We know that from the Israelites, that was one of the first stories of captivity where they were held for a period of time, I think about 400 years. Either way, I believe that's it, but anyway, they was held for a period of time, and then we know Moses led them out, God used Moses to lead them out. So when they came out, there was prosperity. We know that whole, there was a land of milk and honey, all of that. But what we're looking at today, returning from captivity, we're looking at it in this place here where it was Nehemiah, the 7th chapter. Nehemiah was speaking on it, starting in the 4th verse, and we're not going to read the entire thing, but I want you to kind of get in your mind where we're at. Verse 4 says, now the city was large and spacious, but the people in it were left to their feet, and the houses were not rebuilt. Then my God put it into my heart to gather the nobles, the rulers, and the people, that they might be registered by genealogy. And I found a register of genealogy of those who had come up in the first return and found writing in it. And then it goes to follows. It says, these are the people of the promise who came back from captivity, are those who had been carried away, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried away, and who had returned to Jerusalem and Judah, everyone to his city. And then there's a long list of people and how many people that came back from captivity. There's a long list. And they talk about the heads and their people that came back and how many sons and all of the people. And even towards the end, they talk about the captivity. They talk about the animals that returned back. Where are we going today? And it says, although the whole assembly was 42,360, besides their male and their female servants, of whom were 7,367. And they had 225 men and women singers. Then it talks about the animals. Where are we going? So we talked about the amount of people that had went in captivity, y'all following me. And then we talk about the amount of people that came out of captivity. Y'all ready? Let's fast forward to the spirit side. This was the natural side, but you know God does everything in the natural to show us what's going on in the spirit. In the spirit realm, what is captivity? Anybody, Susie. What is captivity in the spirit realm? I'm looking for a three-letter word. Start with S.
Seeing, no thing I think of.
That's it. Seeing in the spirit realm represents captivity. The more sin in your life, the more willingness to dwell in the sin is the more captivity that you have. Now, in y'all young lives, and young age don't mean a thing. Because So I'm kind of trying to move away from labeling you all as youngsters or not ever implying that you don't know anything, because you got the Holy Spirit inside of you. And the Holy Spirit don't have an age. There is no beginning, because check this out. Where do I get that from? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. He's all God. All three of them are God. They just play three different roles. So the Holy Spirit being in you is God being in you. You understand? Did I lose you? I didn't think so. A little tired session. So check this out. Where we going? So the returning from captivity. Can you remember? Can you remember being bound by a particular sin that you knew for a fact was something that God was not pleased with? And then can you remember coming out of it and how good you felt? Can you remember? Thanks for your honesty. Can you remember? I did. Now, the returning from captivity, for me, y'all check this out, because what happened was I was remembering being bound under a particular sin or sins, but especially one in particular. I was bound to the point that whenever the opportunity came by my way, I had to participate. It was like something that almost pulled me to the point where it was almost uncontrollable. That's what sin is. For those that are bound in this sin, it's almost to a point that even when they don't want to do it, it almost overpowers you, so to speak. Does that make sense? It's like, let's go to something that y'all may have seen before. If you cross me, I've seen people, and I've actually been there, okay? Well, if you cross me, I got to get you back. You cuss at me, I got to cuss you out. And it was almost an uncontrollable thing that if you hit me, I got to hit you back. I got to hit you back, and I got to hit you hard, and I'm probably going to hit you multiple times. It was almost uncontrollable because I had no, what's the word I'm looking for? Bearing, but I had no control. I didn't have self-control. You know something that God began to show me? And I want you to pay attention. Y'all get some good stuff. I'm going to say this. Because when we were going about, I don't know about her, because she grew up in a different type of environment where it was more contemporary. I only talk about my environment. Certain things I didn't understand. Let me tell y'all something about the old report cards. And I'm going to tell on me again. I can remember the old style report cards. I don't know if y'all report cards was like this over here in North Carolina. But they had a list when you was in like primary and elementary. On the side, one side of the report card, you show your academics. You got an A, B, C, social studies, science, blah, 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 blah. Other side was about your activity, the way you participated, avoids unnecessary talking, practices self-control. Y'all, did y'all have that? We had that. Well, let me tell myself. And this is what I need to understand. Now, I didn't see this because I knew how I was raised. My parents was never far from the belt. And it was in arm's reach. It seemed like at every given moment, I might receive that belt. So I didn't see what the teacher saw. But if you look at my report cards, in most of my report cards, and I'm going to tell on myself, it says in the category of practice self-control, I had an X. Another X. Each X represented the 6 weeks, right? Y'all was like that? Mine was. Each X represented 6 weeks. And so each one, I had an X, and another X, and another X, and another X. I might have looked up and got a check somewhere, but I got an X most of the time. something that you got to be careful of. If you allow people to speak the wrong things into your life, you find yourself trying to act it out. If I tell you, if I have been stupid enough as your father, as your daddy, to tell you you'll never be nothing, well, guess what? You're kind of going to shoot for a little while. But if I tell you my expectations of you are great and I see the great things in you, then you're going to constantly continue to pull because you see and you recognize that people see greatness in you. And you're going to continue to achieve it and look to be great. Am I wrong? So what I recognize that by looking at the report card and it says avoid unnecessary talking, I did it halfway good. But the practicing self-control, it made it look like I did not have control over my own body. Which made me not fight so hard when the enemy decided to start trying to give me lures to get me out of the proper place of God. Where am I going? That gave the mindset of leading me into captivity. Of sin. As I said, there were certain sins, one in particular, and the opportunity presented itself, I felt like I had to participate. And so check this out. Where are we going? Returning from captivity. What God began to explain to me, why is this about prayer events? And I want you to catch this. What God began to explain to me this morning, that the hearts of many will begin to turn back to Him. The hearts of many are about to turn back to Him. That is a blessing, y'all. I don't know if you understand what I just said, but that means those that were bound to go to hell, those that were about to participate in unlawful or sinful behaviors that would ruin the rest of their life or hurt somebody else, are about to return back to God. Meaning, the less people that you have on the devil's side causing more harm. Do you see the picture? That's what God began to give me this morning. The returning from captivity is that the hearts of man is about to turn back to God. The last time I can remember God giving me messages like this was before COVID. When God was telling me how He was going to bring judgment upon the world. Not long after that, COVID came. So I'm saying today that this is the blessing of God, that many hearts are about to turn back to God. I don't know what occasion it's going to be. I don't know if it's an eclipse. One thing I'm going to say else that God told me. He did tell me this morning that the thing that He's using, He's involved in. So I don't know if it's going to be a situation where it looks like God is like completely not there. That's going to turn people's hearts back to God. Or what it is. But He did inform me that He's there in the midst. Might not make a whole lot to y'all. But the fact that people's heart are going to turn back to God and not go to hell, that blesses me. Amen? So I say to you on the day, this is it. This is what God gave me. I just took and went down and read line for line, but that wasn't necessary. I say to you on the day, continue with the intercessory prayer. You know what intercessory prayer is? It's when you're praying for other people. It's when you're praying for other people. Because God has already let us know now that many hearts are about to turn back to God. And that blesses me on no end because I don't know about you, sometimes I get real tired of all the chaos I've seen in everyday life. And so we wonder, some of us that has been around for a while may say, how did we get this bad? Well, it's the opposite of what God said today. We turned our hearts away from God. So now God's going to turn us back. And so I thank God for it. I think the last time, well, no. Because many hearts turned to God during COVID. And before that was what, 9/11? Many hearts turned to God in 9/11. Church is back. And And it's not even about the building itself. It's about the fact that when people begin to submit to God's will. And so this is what God gave us today. I'm not going to add to it, and I can't take away from it. But this is what God gave us. So as we see this, understand that God will let us know about it. That many are going to begin, you're going to start hearing people begin to talk about God more and their love for God. Because God does not lie. Many hearts will turn back to him. Amen? Let us pray. God, I thank you for your word on today. Father, I thank you for what you're doing. I thank you for the celebration, God, that I feel, and I feel that I'm within your people because people are going to turn back to you. So, God, I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Father, that whatever occasion you use, that we will not forget that you are in the midst, that you are in the control. God, let every child of God know down within the deep parts of them that you are in control. So, Lord, thank you. Have your way with your children. Have your way so that we will know without a shadow of doubt you're still in control. Thank you, Father. For it is in your name we pray, your presence that we pray, and the doorway that you open, we stand in. Because the veil was rent. Thank you, Father. Amen. I'm going to ask my wife to play a closing song, and this is what God gave us. Do y'all have any questions? Do you? You got any questions?
Was that the first one in your...
Yes. Yes. Adam was the first name son. Adam first. First humans. Because why? Animals, because I'm real correct, that God created the animals first. Thank you.